Welcome to Relaxing Boutique Channel. Finding moments of peace in the hustle and bustle of our lives can be a bit challenging. Our channel is your sanctuary, a place where captivating tales blend with soothing tones, guiding you toward restful slumber. Escape from the noise, let go of the day's stresses, and allow our stories to transport you to realms of tranquility and dreams. Whether you're seeking relaxation, meditation, or simply a good night's sleep, you're in the right place. So, settle in, close your eyes, and let the journey to serenity begin. In our unceasing journey through the corridors of life, moments of pure, unadulterated tranquility can sometimes seem as elusive as shadows at noon. The modern world is a symphony of endless noises, from the incessant hum of digital screens to the ceaseless whispers of obligations, commitments, and desires. In this symphony, our souls often search for a gentle lullaby, a melodious escape, a chance to pause, breathe, and simply be. Now, as you find yourself here in the magic of this narrative oasis, know that you've stumbled upon a sanctuary, a world where serenity isn't just a luxury, but a promise. Picture, if you will, a secluded haven nestled amidst nature's embrace, where the wind hums lullabies, and time itself seems to tread lightly. This is where we invite you to journey with us, a place of meditation, reflection, and utter calm. Begin by taking a deep, resolute breath. Feel the cool air grace your nostrils, traveling through the depths of your lungs, filling your being with the ancient rhythms of existence. And then, as you exhale, imagine releasing the shackles of worry, stress, and the relentless march of time. Each subsequent breath is a step deeper into the heart of tranquility, a dance with the universe, an affirmation of the present moment. We live in an era where the very essence of our existence often feels fragmented. Pulled in myriad directions by demands, expectations, and the invisible threads of technology, it's easy to lose oneself. But these tales, each a gem sculpted from the rich tapestries of imagination and insight, seek to offer you a bridge. A bridge not just to sleep, but that in itself is a cherished realm of restoration, but to a state of soulful relaxation, where the world narrows down to the here and now, where every heartbeat is a reminder of life's simple beauties. These stories are not just words. They are portals. They beckon you into worlds where the pace is gentler, the colors more vivid, and the sounds harmoniously aligned with the rhythms of the cosmos. Here, amidst these tales, you'll find characters and landscapes that resonate with the deepest parts of your psyche, invoking a sense of familiarity and nostalgia. They're like old friends or forgotten dreams, waiting to welcome you back. As you immerse yourself in these narratives, let the outside world fade into soft focus. Envision your stresses and anxieties as leaves carried away by a gentle stream, disappearing beyond the horizon. Let the weight of expectation, the clamor of responsibilities, and the noise of uncertainty be replaced by the soothing cadences of these stories. Every word, every phrase, is a brushstroke painting a world of peace, inviting you to step in and explore. Sleep, that precious gift, is not just a physical necessity but a balm for the soul. It's nature's way of healing, restoring, and rejuvenating. As you stand at the threshold of dreams, these tales are the gentle hands guiding you towards restful slumber. They remind you of the beauty of surrender, of letting go, of drifting into the comforting embrace of night. So, dear listener, as you embark on this journey with us, know that you are not alone. Through the magic of these tales, we are with you, sharing in your quest for tranquility and deep, restorative sleep. Let these stories be your anchor, your lighthouse, guiding you away from the tempests of daily life and into the calm waters of relaxation and dreams. Welcome to our sanctuary. Let the journey to serenity begin. Journey through the Citadel of Troy. Chapter 1. The Whispering Ruins. The sun had not yet chased away the chill of the early morning when Dr. Adrian Holloway stepped onto the storied ground of ancient Troy. He had traveled from far, from a land of steel and glass, to this place of myth and memory. The Troas landscape was stark, beautiful, the rolling hills whispering of a time when gods and men fought for glory and honor. His boots scuffed the hallowed earth as he walked, a lone figure among the stones that had seen the dawn and dusk of civilizations. Each step was measured, taken with the reverence due to one of history's most legendary locales. The ruins of Troy stretched before him, their once insurmountable walls now little more than foundations and rubble, yet still majestic in their decay. With a canvas bag slung over his shoulder, filled with notebooks, sketches, and tools of his trade, Adrian moved toward what had been the Aegean gates. He paused, envisioning the throngs that had passed through these gates, merchants from distant lands, ambassadors from enemy cities, and the proud Trojan warriors of yore. The whispers began as the wind, murmuring through the stone corridors and shattered arches. They seemed to speak in the tongues of many, the guttural Greek of Agamemnon's armies, the lyrical flow of the Trojans, and even the hushed, ancient dialects of civilizations that predated the famed city. Adrian closed his eyes, allowing the breeze to wash over him, bringing with it the scent of thyme and salt from the sea, the fragrance as old as the tales that had drawn him here. Opening his eyes, he began his work, sketching the layout as it stood before him, jotting down his initial observations. He traced the lineage of the stones, their composition telling of trade routes and alliances, their scars revealing the battles fought and the sieges withstood. His fingers danced over the fluted columns, down to the masonry where chariots had once rolled by, their wheels wearing grooves into the stone. He set up a tripod and began taking a series of photographs, capturing the play of light and shadow, the stark contrast between ancient glory and present desolation. Adrian's work was not just about the physical remnants, it was about capturing the essence of Troy, its spirit that had survived poets, painters, and historians. Midday approached, and the sun beat down upon the earth, the heat unearthing the smell of dry dust and ancient secrets. Adrian found himself at the edge of what might have been the marketplace. Here, commerce and gossip once intertwined, where bronze had clinked and olives had been bartered. He knelt, running his hand through the soil, and unearthed a shard of pottery. Its edges were jagged, but a section of painting remained, perhaps a fragment of Apollo's lyre or the curve of a warrior's helmet. Hours turned, and Adrian documented meticulously, moving from the marketplace to the remnants of temples. The gods of Olympus were worshipped here, their temples grand and resplendent. Now only the foundations remained, and in these sacred precincts he could almost hear the echo of prayers and the footsteps of priests. As the afternoon waned, Adrian ventured to the outskirts of the ruins, where everyday life had once flourished. Here, the remains of homes clung to the earth, their walls still holding the warmth of the families that had laughed and wept within them. He imagined the city in its heyday, children playing in the streets, the murmur of voices, the scent of cooking fires, and the rhythm of looms weaving cloth. The day's end found him on the rise where King Priam's palace had once stood, commanding the city and the sea beyond. The palace was gone, but the grandeur remained in the expanse of the horizon, the setting sun igniting the sky in a blaze of gold and crimson, much like the fires that had consumed the city in its final days. Adrian set up his camp in the lee of a large ruin, sheltered from the winds. As night descended, the stars came forth, a celestial tapestry unmarred by the lights of modern civilization. The constellations were the same as the ones the ancient Trojans had seen, the Great Bear, Orion the Hunter, and Scorpius with its heart, Antares, pulsing red in the night sky. The ruins whispered louder at night, and Adrian lay awake, listening. They spoke of the valor of Hector, the wrath of Achilles, the beauty of Helen, and the folly of Paris. They whispered of the way of history, the burden of legend, and the threads of truth woven through the tapestry of myth. Here, in the whispering ruins, the past was alive, and Adrian Holloway was there to listen and to learn. His journey through the Citadel of Troy was only beginning, and the stones had many tales yet to tell. Chapter 2. Echoes of War. Dr. Adrian Holloway woke to a dawn chorus of birdsong, a melody that seemed timeless, untouched by the centuries. With the morning light softening the harsh lines of the ancient city, he sipped bitter coffee brew over his portable camping stove, the scent mingling with the earthy aroma of the ruins. Today's task was to uncover more of Troy's violent past, the echoes of war that seemed to resonate from every stone and broken column. After a frugal breakfast, he packed his tools, a fine brush, a trowel, a notebook, and a camera, before making his way to the northern sector of the city, where historians speculated the fiercest battles may have occurred. He arrived at a sloping hillside, where scattered stones hinted at a once formidable defensive structure. The strategic position offered a panoramic view of the plains below, where, according to legend, the Greeks had laid siege for 10 long years. Adrian pictured the scene, a landscape teeming with encamped soldiers, the glint of sunlight on armor, and the constant tension of impending battle. He began to excavate near what appeared to be a collapsed section of wall, carefully brushing away centuries of accumulated dirt. The work was meticulous, the midday sun hot on his back as he uncovered an array of artifacts, arrowheads of bronze, their edges dulled by time, the remains of a shield, its wood long since rotted away, leaving only the corroded bronze boss, and a myriad of broken pottery pieces, some with discernible patterns that spoke of their origins. Each item was cataloged and placed carefully into labeled bags for further study. Adrian's hands were steady, but his heart raced with each discovery. These were tangible connections to the Homeric epics, to the warriors who had fought and died on this very ground. By late afternoon, he had uncovered a section of ground that was discolored, a dark, ashen stain spread across the soil. Charred remnants of ancient timber and scorched earth lay beneath the layer of dirt, evidence of a fire that had raged through this part of the city. Perhaps it was a section of Troy that had felt the wrath of the Greek onslaught, a testament to the city's violent end. Adrian documented the find with high-resolution photographs and careful notes. He sketched the layout, imagining how the wall might have stood before the fury of the invaders brought it down. The soil around the burn layer was packed with fragments of weapons and armor, as if the very ground bore the scars of war. As the sun dipped below the horizon, casting long shadows across the dig site, Adrian sat back on his heels. He took a moment to consider the lives lost in the siege, the dreams that had crumbled along with the walls. His fingers traced the outline of a spearhead, and he felt the weight of history in his palm. It was not just the clash of bronze and the cries of warriors that haunted these ruins. There were also the silent struggles of the people within the city, those who had watched and waited behind these very walls, whose lives had been upended by the protracted war. The night was falling quickly, and Adrian gathered his tools, preparing to return to his campsite. As he did, he heard the faintest of sounds, like the murmur of distant voices. He paused, straining his ears, but the sound faded as quickly as it had come, leaving him to wonder if it had been the wind playing tricks or if, perhaps, the echoes of the past were more than just metaphors. Back at his tent, with the light of a small campfire flickering against the night, Adrian opened his notebook and began to write. He recorded the day's finds, his hypotheses, and his reflections. The narrative of Troy was slowly coming together, piece by piece, through the objects left behind by its inhabitants. He fell asleep to the crackling of the fire and the quiet hum of the Aegean in the distance, dreaming of chariots and war cries, of a city both vibrant and doomed. In his dreams, Troy rose from its ashes, its walls whole and proud, only to fall once more, succumbing to the echoes of war that still reverberated through its ancient stones. Chapter 3. The Bonds of Gods and Men. Adrian Holloway began the day with an air of expectancy. The previous day's discoveries had set the stage for a deeper exploration into the spiritual life of ancient Troy. The excavation at the possible temple site beckoned, a place where the lines between the mortal world and that of the gods were once whispered to be thin. Upon reaching the site, Adrian stood before a cluster of collapsed columns, their once magnificent capitals now lay strewn about like the playthings of fallen deities. The air was still, as if the ancient gods were watching, curious about the mortal who dared tread upon their sacred ground. Today, he would delve into the remnants of what he believed to be the temple of Athena, the goddess of wisdom and warfare, who played a pivotal role in the mythos of Troy. The irony of seeking the wisdom of a long-fallen civilization was not lost on him, but he felt a magnetic pull towards the knowledge that lay buried within these ruins. His hands worked carefully, methodically uncovering layers of history. Potsherds with faint inscriptions surfaced, suggesting hymns or prayers to the goddess. He found a cache of votive offerings, small figurines in the shape of owls, the symbol of Athena, laid there by worshippers in hope of divine favor or in thanks for blessings received. The deeper he dug, the more the atmosphere around him seemed charged with an ethereal energy. The sun bore down, casting stark shadows that played across the stone like dancing spirits. As the hours passed, Adrian exposed a mosaic floor, its tiles still vibrant with color, depicting the mighty Achilles dragging Hector's body in a gruesome testament to divine favoritism and the horrors of war. His sketches and notes became more fervent as he pieced together the temple's layout. A central hearth was now visible, around which the faithful would have gathered, seeking communion with Athena. Adrian's fingers traced the soot-blackened stones, and he was struck by the continuity of human hope and despair, the need to reach out to something greater. Excitement pulsed through him as he unearthed the statue's head, the features eroded but unmistakably that of Athena, her gaze once piercing, now softened by time. It was an intimate connection to the past, a face looked upon by the ancients, perhaps sought in times of crisis or contemplation. As the day faded to evening, and the excavation site was bathed in the warm glow of twilight, Adrian sat back on his haunches and took a moment to absorb the enormity of the place and the passage of time. Here, where people once offered their deepest fears and highest hopes, he too found himself reaching out across the ages, connecting to the multitude of souls that had once animated these stones. The night was spent cataloging the findings, his headlamp casting a circle of light in the darkness as he worked. The silence of the night was profound, broken only by the scratching of his pen and the occasional distant hoot of an owl, a living echo of the temple's sacred bird. In the solitude of the ancient temple, Adrian felt a profound sense of peace, as if the goddess herself had bestowed it upon him. He pondered the power of belief, how it shaped civilizations, drove men to war, and brought them to their knees in worship. Sleep came uneasily, filled with dreams of processions and sacrifices, of whispered incantations and the gaze of a statue that seemed to pierce through the veil of time. He dreamt of the city at the height of its power, its people vibrant and alive, and he awoke with a start to find the first light of dawn spilling over the ruins. With each day's findings, Adrian was reconstructing more than a city. He was reviving a complex tapestry of human experience that had once been woven into the very fabric of Troy. The task was immense, but he was committed to honoring the history and legacy of this storied place. As he prepared for another day of digging, Adrian knew that the work ahead would not just unearth artifacts, but would also resurrect the spirits of those who had once walked the streets of Troy, who had lived, loved, fought, and worshipped within the city's storied walls. Chapter 4. The Threads of Destiny. The dawn of Adrian Holloway's final week at the site was marked by a storm. Dark clouds loomed over the ancient city, and the winds whispered through the ruins like the voices of a thousand ghosts. As he made his way to the excavation site, the first drops of rain began to fall, gentle at first, then growing in strength, as if the heavens were mourning the lost city of Troy. Today, he would be exploring a recently discovered lower stratum of the site, which preliminary findings suggested might predate the Trojan War. This layer, hidden for millennia, promised to reveal secrets untold, a narrative untouched by the epic tales of Homer. As the rain subsided to a light drizzle, Adrian stood at the edge of a deep pit that opened up like a window to the past. He descended carefully, his boots slipping on the wet earth. The air grew cooler as he went deeper, the weight of centuries pressing around him. He began to work at the edge of the layer, where the change in soil composition was evident. His trowel struck something hard, and he cleared the mud to reveal the edge of a large stone slab. It was meticulously carved with intricate designs that he had never seen before in Mycenaean or Trojan art. This was something older, something different. With painstaking care, he unearthed the slab, revealing it to be a door of sorts, leading to what he could only guess was a tomb or a treasure chamber. His heart pounded with the possibility of what lay beyond. Was it the resting place of a king long forgotten, a cache of treasures that predated the legendary wealth of Priam, or perhaps a chamber of records that would rewrite the early history of the region? He documented the find, photographing the carvings, which seemed to depict a procession of figures, both human and divine. There were scenes of everyday life, of harvest and hunt, and of ritualistic dances that hinted at a civilization steeped in both agricultural and mystical practices. As Adrian worked, the chamber began to reveal its secrets. Within, he found remnants of pottery that bore a resemblance to the famed Trojan ceramics, yet distinct in their iconography. The figures were elongated, almost ethereal, with eyes that seemed to follow his every movement. The artifacts here were remarkably well preserved, protected from time by the sealed environment. Amongst the earthenware, he discovered tablets inscribed with a script that was undecipherable to him. It was linear, precise, but unlike any ancient writing he had encountered. It was a language lost to time, holding within it the potential to unlock a civilization's history, a narrative separate from the tales of Achilles and Hector, a story that might predate even the oldest myths of the Greek world. Hours turned to days as Adrian and his team cataloged the chamber's contents. Each item was carefully removed and preserved for transport to the museum, where it would be studied in detail. The tablets, in particular, were a source of deep intrigue. If he could decipher them, Adrian might reveal the voice of this ancient people, hear their stories in their own words. The task was monumental, the implications staggering. This was no longer just an excavation, it was a journey into the very dawn of history in this storied region. The team worked with a sense of reverence, aware that they were unearthing a chapter of human history that had been silent for over 3,000 years. Adrian often found himself pausing to touch the walls of the chamber, feeling the grooves of the carvings, the cold press of the stone. It was as if by touching it, he could bridge the gap between his life and those who had carved these images with such care and artistry so long ago. On the final day of the excavation, as the last of the artifacts was being packed away, Adrian sat alone in the chamber, the light from the surface casting a dim glow over the space. He felt a profound connection to this place, a sense of kinship with the long-dead artisans and scribes who had left their marks upon these stones. The quiet was deep, sacred in its silence. And in that silence, Adrian allowed himself to feel the weight of his discoveries, the responsibility of the stories he would tell, and the history he would bring to light. It was a burden he accepted willingly, a duty to the past, to honor the lives and legacies of those who had walked before him in this ancient city. As he climbed out of the chamber, back into the light of the present day, Adrian knew that his life's work was forever altered. He had unearthed a civilization that had been hidden beneath Troy's shadow, waiting for millennia to be rediscovered and to have its tales told once again.